ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पतः श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे ॐ आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि वाक् प्राणश्चक्षुःश्रोत्रमथो बलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्मोपनिषदम् माहं ब्रह्म निराकुर्याम् अनिराकरणमस्त्वनिराकरणं मेऽस्तु तदात्मनि निरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्माः ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। इह चेदवेदीत् अथ सत्यमस्ति न चेदिहावेदीत् महती विनष्टिः भूतेषु भूतेषु विचित्यधीराः प्रेत्यास्माल्लोकात् अमृता भवन्ति। इहैव ब्रह्मवेदनं सम्पादयितव्यम्। दट् इस् दि topic of this mantra. In this world and in this birth, that is the meaning of iha. So the tendency to postpone to next birth is not useful, and also trying to say kramamukti, there is such a description, kramamukti they say, means you can do some punyam and go to brahmaloka, some kind of a higher level of heaven, and there again you can learn, and again Brahmaji will teach the same thing, he will teach. So tatvamasi alone he will teach, he cannot teach anything other than that. So because he cannot improve upon the reality, if he can improve upon the reality, then it will not be reality in any case, and it will not be what it is. Therefore you may not even postpone to another birth or to another loka. In this birth, in this loka, you try to accomplish it. You need not even really accomplish also, because you are the liberated, you are liberated, nitya mukta. Only thing is, you should know it. You see, if there is, the goal is outside of me, that is a different situation. But in this situation, this is a very peculiar thing. Here is, I am the goal, I am the method, and I am the means. That is what it is. So goal, method, and means are all myself. Therefore, what is the point in postponing and the suffering till that point unnecessary? We can learn to know the truth now itself. So the idea is, this is a goal in life. This is the inner purpose of life. Outer purpose of life is there, making some money and enjoying a few good things, and then even acquiring a little virtue, dharmartha kama. This is the outer purpose of life. But that can be there. This won't come in its way. It can go on within the bottom line being that you do not transgress dharma. So that being the bottom line, you can pursue artha kama, no problem. But beyond a point, that means beyond the minimum means for simple existence, beyond that, any further effort is wasteful. So one has to recognize that. And having recognized that, we should struggle to liberate the universal person embedded in this personality. Or you can say it the other way. You can resolve the individual, the personality in the reality, in the impersonal reality. So, if this spiritual direction is not there in our life, ihacheda vedit, you know, that is the spirit of this mantra. If we do not have this spiritual direction in life, then every action that we undertake, every action and every thought, there can be no life without these two. What is life? Thoughts and actions. That is what life is. And without this spiritual direction, ihacheda vedit, without it, every thought and every action serves to throw us deeper and deeper into the net of delusion, that is samsara, and increase the tension in life. So, this worldliness, this egocentric life, which we call samsara, which is the worldliness, that life is like that. It increases sorrow and tension. So, it is a very static life. In spite of an elaborate movement that is seen in artha kama, a lot of movement is there, but it is a very static life. Because you start this movement called life at the age of 10 or 12 for some petty gains, and even after 60 years or 70 years of this movement, still you are in the same movement. What kind of, is it not static? I do not see anything dynamic in it. Real dynamic life is when you make vertical progress, not horizontal progress. I have 1 million and make 1 more million. Is it a progress? I have one pleasure and I get hold of another pleasure. Is it a progress? So, this horizontal progress is not a progress at all. It is a very unbecoming of human life to just get stuck at the level of artha kama and fail to make any progress in the vertical direction. Vertical direction means the person comes to know the impersonal reality, the deeper dimension of his own personality, which is impersonal reality, he comes to know that. That is the direction one has to take. Ihacheda vedi datha satyamasti. If he does it, satyamasti. There is some meaning in life. Paramarthatava satyam vidyate. That is Shankara. So, having gained human life, you can say, the human life, whatever glory is there in it, it is put to good use. Otherwise, it's a wasted thing. The otherwise is now coming. Bhashya. Nachediha avedit. So, the second vakya is Nachediha avedit. Yeah, that alone. that is the vakya. So, Nachediha avedit. He puts the sentence. He takes the meaning, the mantra sentence, and puts there in the bhashyam. It means, nachediha avedit iti vakyam vyakshayate. That is the meaning of it. So now I explain the sentence, nachediha avedit. That is the meaning of it. Otherwise, why he should put it there again? For that reason, the bhashyakara puts it. It is called pratika. Anyway, now he is doing vyakhyanam. Nachediha jivaunschet adhikrutaha avedit naviditavan tada mahati dirgha ananta vinashtihi vinashanam janma jara marana diprabandha vicheda lakshana maranadi prabandha vicheda lakshana. If you say carefully, you will not miss it. Samsara gatihi. Nachediha vedit. Iha means jivan. While living, nached adhikrutaha. Adhikrutaha, adhikari shariram. The upadhi, the mind, body mind, is adhikari shariram. It is a marvelous tool of action and cognition, and it is given, and the person is unable to do anything with it. It is like you give a super computer to a bunch of people who cannot put it to good use. Then what they will do with it? So they will. It is like giving a diamond to a person playing marbles in the street. He will use it as a marble. This diamond, he will use it as a marble, and then he will throw it also because it is not as good as any other marble. So that is how this life is given. And na avedit, na viditavan. He did not know the truth. The truth of the innermost reality of a dog, a mosquito, a fly is also Brahman. It is life. Everywhere it is life, the glory of life, and that life is Brahman. In every living being, the life is Brahman. But the dog or a mosquito or a fly have no means to know that truth. Whereas a human being has the means to know the truth. Na viditavan, but he did not use that opportunity. So they say 84 lakh, 84 lakh. Possible life forms are there. 84 lakh means 840,000. That means 8.4 million. Possible life forms are there. That is the diversity of life forms. And so the statistical probability of taking birth as a human being is 1 by 8.4 million. That is the statistical probability. And you made it. That is the point. So we made it. Almost zero probability. Close to zero. 1 by 8.4 million is what? It is almost zero. Close to zero. But yet we made it. Sometimes it is 99% probable and we miss it. But here it is close to zero and we made it. So then we have wasted it. Suppose. That's why suppose yadi. It's not that we wasted it. Yadi. So mahati vanashtihi. Mahati means dirgha. Ananta vanashtihi. It's a long felt loss. It's a loss that will be felt for a long time to come. That is the meaning of dirgha, ananta. Almost to endless time. It's an endless time. The loss is felt. So how? Vinashtihi means vinashanam. It's a destruction. So that means what? Dirgha samsara gatihi. That is the vinashanam here. It's not that something is going to crash down or any such thing, or something is going to burn and become ashes. It is not the idea. It's a description. It only means vinashanam. The destruction here is the person will... he will fall into endless life of endless worldly life, samsara gatihi, the life of becoming. So now he is a human being, he will become old, now he is middle age, he will become old, he will become sick, he may become rich temporarily in between, and then again he will lose that riches, finally he will die, die is also becoming. And then he will take birth, another becoming. And then the whole thing continues. That is what he is saying, janma marana. So he dies here, he was born here, and therefore he will die here. Here means in this body and in this loka. And then having died here, he will take birth elsewhere, in another body, in another loka. Loka means again may come back as bhuloka, but again it is called another loka because it is not the same waking state. The waking state of a human being is not the same as that of a dog. And again, between two human beings, they do not have the same waking state. They have each has his own waking state. A Texas millionaire's son wakes up to a world which is altogether different from the world of a poor guy in a slum. Therefore, everybody wakes up to a different world. Everybody is born into a different world, though it appears as the same world. There is nothing like same world. So, it looks like that. If you do not carefully investigate, it looks like that. Nothing more than that. Anyway, So this is janma marana. Again, having born to another life in another place, then again death. And in between jara. So old age. So it continues. Adi, adi shibdena, shoka, moha, fears, this, that. It will continue. This is prabandha means structure. This is structure, it's a package. Birth means death at the end, waiting at the end of the tunnel, or at the end of the road, and in between there are shoka, moha, jara, etc., old age and all that. It's a package. It's a structure. This structure, avicheda, it is not going to disappear. It is not going to loosen its hold. It continues to grip this person. And so this cycle continues. Lakshana, in that form, this is called samsara gatihi. So the journey of samsara is like this. This is the nature of that samsara gatihi. So the person will fall into that gati. Because no guarantee that the person will come back as a human being again. So, because you see, in Bhagavatam it is said in one place, Esha buddhimatam buddhihi, sa manisha manishinam, yat satya manurute neha, martyen atnoti mamrutam. Very interesting verse. So, this is intelligence of intelligent people. This is the earnestness of people who have that Shraddha. What is it? This body, this life is immortal. It is mortal, martya, and unreal. So, with a mortal and unreal living, utilizing, that is the means. The mortal and unreal living is the means, the human life. And yet, it can be used to gain the immortality and the reality. What you pay the price is finite, and what you gain is infinite. That is, yat martyena amrutam apnoti. You invest the mortal life and you gain immortality. So this is the glory of human life, and this should not be missed. Tasmat evam gunadoshau vijanantaha brahmanah bhuteshu bhuteshu sarvabhuteshu sthavareshu chereshu cha ekamatmatattvam brahmavichitya vijnaya sakshatkritya dhiradhimantaha. Tasmat therefore brahmana bhuteshu bhuteshu vichitya dhiraha. So brahmanaha means brahmani rataha. Brahma is the supreme reality, rataha. So those who have a love for that reality is brahmana. So then brahma vedaha or vedanta. Vedanta is also part of Veda. So brahmani rataha. So vedanta vakyeshu sadaramantaha. Shankara. They are the brahmanaha. So always enjoying the study of the statements of Vedanta. Vedanta Vakya. Vedanta Vakyeshu Sadaramantaha. So those Vakyas. So one need not worry that the 1 month course is over and then what happens. There is no such a thing. No need for that kind of thinking. Because what a person needs is Vedanta Vakya. Vedanta Vakyeshu Sadaramantaha. So even in the old fashioned Gurukula systems, so the teacher teaches the student for some time and then the student takes it forward. The teacher only shows the way. He won't walk with the person. The person should not expect that way also. He will only show the way. Suppose you ask the path to go to Eastern. What should I do? Suppose you ask somebody there And so you want him to run before your car or what? No, he will show the way. You take this exit and go 10 miles straight. You will see eastern exit and he will go his way. So that's why Vedanta Vakyeshu Sadaramantaha. We should learn to enjoy Vedanta Vakyas. That is important. So these are the persons, Brahmana. Guna dosha vijanantaha. When you know the dosha, then you can appreciate guna. It goes together. In fact, in Sanskrit we have a shastra called poetics. We call it Alankara Shastra. So writing a poem or reading a poem, poem means Kalidasa, Valmiki, like this kind of poetry. So what are the good points and what are the bad points? They are discussed. So there are two sections. One is guna prakaranam and the other is the dosha prakaranam. Prakaranam is a section. So gunas and doshas. So first doshas will come. So I one time asked the teacher, what is it? This always beginning is dosha, then comes guna. The teacher told that is the right way to approach things. So you know dosha. Dosha means blemish. First you know the blemishes and get rid of the blemishes. Gunas will come automatically into it. Now what we do, we keep all the doshas intact, all the blemishes intact, and we want gunas to come in. It won't happen. So, you see, one Mahatma was there. His name is Ananda Swami. Generally, Swami's names are the other way. Swami this, that, like that. But his name is Ananda Swami. He used to be in Delhi, a great Mahatma. So, he used to emphasize Vairagyam. You should develop dispassion and all that. So, one Amma told him, Swamiji, why you bother us with Vairagyam and all that? You teach us the truth. Finally, it is not Vairagyam which will give moksha. Whether Vairagyan moksha or Jnanan moksha, you tell me that first, let me know that. Then he told, Jnanan moksha, yeah, by knowledge alone you will get moksha. So you mean that Vairagyat moksha na? No, Vairagyat na moksha. Jnanan moksha. Then why you bother us with Vairagyam? Why not Jnana? He told, yeah, there is a point in it. I will think about it and I will answer your question tomorrow. She told, okay, I will come tomorrow evening again class to the class, evening class. Then he told, Amma, will you give bhiksha to me tomorrow morning? She did not invite him. You only told. He said, okay. She said, oh, yeah, I will give bhiksha. Okay, you give me your address. So she wrote on a piece of paper and gave it to him. Next day morning, he told his shishya, so I am going to bhiksha to this house. And he took his bowl. He has a bowl, begging bowl or whatever you call it. And he took that bowl. And he went to her house. And she invited and he sat there. And so he put this bowl before her and asked her, you put this bhiksha into this bowl. Then she took the bowl. It was all dirty. There was so much dirt in it. She said, oh, Swamiji, what is this? Okay, I'll nicely wash it. And no, don't wash. You put bhiksha in it. She told her, no, I cannot put bhiksha in it. It's too dirty. It is smelling and dirty. She can see dirt all around and it is smelling bad. Chichi, I can't put bhiksha in it. No, you put in it. I will take bhiksha. Why you worry? You put in it. No, Swamiji, I cannot do it. Similarly, unless vairagyam is there, unless doshas are removed, you cannot gain jnanam. Jnana bhiksha it is called. Bhiksha, bhikshandeh, jnana bhiksha. Therefore, jnana bhiksha can be given into the vessel of mind only when the vessel of mind is pure. You see, it is dirty and smelling bad, so Bhagavan won't come into that mind. Because jnana is Bhagavan. It is called jnanavatara. So Bhagavan has to descend into the heart, and that is atma jnanam. That is, there is no other jnanam. That is the jnanam. Bhaktas call it Bhagavan manifesting in the heart. That is what bhaktas say. We say atma is Brahman. Both are one and the same. Only language is different. So, if the heart is smelling bad with all kinds of wrong emotions like jealousy and anger and all that, సో హౌ భగవాన్ విల్ కమ్ దేర్? హీ విల్ రన్ అవే ఫ్రమ్ దేర్. సో దట్స్ వై దోష ప్రకరణం. ఫస్ట్ దోష, ఫైండ్ అవుట్ వాట్ ఆర్ ఆల్ ది బ్లెమిషెస్, యు టేక్ కేర్ ఆఫ్ దమ్. వెన్ ఎ గెస్ట్ కమ్స్ యు మే నాట్ గివ్ హిమ్ వండర్ఫుల్ డిన్నర్ ఆఫ్ 5 courses అండ్ ఆల్ దాట్. యు కీప్ ది ప్లేస్ క్లీన్ సో దట్ హీ కెన్ కమ్ అండ్ సిట్ దేర్ ఇన్ అ సింపుల్ చైర్. You need not have a sofa, but if this chair is clean, that is enough. He sits there and takes a cup of water. You may give something and he will take and he will move on. Mahatma is not going to be impressed by big things anyway. So, dosha prakaranam. So, guna dosha. So, Shankara said guna dosha. But the starting point is dosha. You know doshas, eliminate them. Gunas will come automatically. Vijanantaha. So, one has to know this and make his heart pure, then he is dhiraha, dhimantaha, that viveka. Viveka is guna dosha viveka. Wherever dhira word comes, it is viveka, discrimination. So, with that, they will find out the truth. How they will find out? Bhuteshu bhuteshu vichitya dhiraha. So, pratibodha viditam matam. So, it's not that you are going to sit like this whole day. Morning you get up, take breakfast and sit like this. Again take lunch and sit like this. It's not like that. To live means to function. So, you need not sit like this pratibodha all the time. You know that the truth is discovered in pratibodha. But truth is not limited to pratibodha. Truth is discovered in pratibodha. Not limited to pratibodha. If I want to see the sun, I can catch that reflection and see. If a mirror is kept in that reflection, and the mirror is focused this side, and I look at that mirror, I can see sun. So I can discover sun. But sun is not limited to the mirror and the reflection. So pratibodha is okay, but then all bodha is also pervaded by Ishvara alone, the Atma alone. Bhuteshu bhuteshu vichitya. Bhuteshu bhuteshu means sarva bhuteshu, vipsa. So saying twice means all. So this is a very beautiful Sanskrit usage. Whenever the same word is repeated, it means all. Indriyasyendriyasyarthe means every indriya. Bhuteshu bhuteshu, all bhutas. Or you can say sthavareshu chareshu cha. So moving and non-moving. Bhuta is a life form. So moving, all birds, creatures, animals and other humans. Non-moving, trees, plants, grass, all this is non-moving. So in all these living beings, there is one life. So you see, they ask a question. Is life Brahman? Brahman is not something more than life? Yes, Brahman is something more than life. Even non-life is also Brahman. But you start with life, we will see. Start with life. Suppose I ask you, look at this stone as Brahman. How does it sound to you? Suppose I say, look at this animal as Brahman. The glory of Brahman is manifest in this animal as life, as the power of cognition and as the power of action. Now you understand. You know how you understand? Because you yourself are identified with the physical body and you yourself harness this power of life and power of action and power of cognition every day. And the same thing is manifest everywhere. That sentience, you are a sentient being. And therefore, sentience means something to you very special. Knowing that I am a sentient being is easier than knowing that I am being. Which is easy? I am being is a bit more difficult. Once you know that, then you need not be taught anything. But you take yourself to be a sentient being. That's why the message is, the sentience, that is your capital, that is your innermost reality, is there in the entire marvel of life on this globe, and you recognize it and see that sentience is one. Sentient beings are many, sentience is one. What is sentience? I know that I exist. That is sentience. The creature knows that it exists, sentience. The animal knows that it exists, sentience. That's why it is roaming around. The bird knows that it exists, it is sentience. So look at that sentience. That is Brahma. No, then what happens to stones, etc.? Will they not be Brahma? Yeah, this is the problem. You will know stones also is Brahma. First know this. Dhiraha. So, everything is Brahman. But everything is Brahman is the ultimate reality when the person, that is the vision. Start where you are. You take yourself to be a sentient being. Start at that point. And recognize what is the sentience. Look into your life. What is the capital of your life? Sentience. That sentience, is it different from any other life form? No. So, bhuteshu bhuteshu vichitya dhiraha. Look at yourself and look at every other life form and recognize the common reality. Don't be carried away by the differences. Differences are there. This body is different from another body. The animal body is different from human body. Don't be carried away by the differences. Search for vichitya. See, what you see is difference. What you search out is the commonality. And then, if difference and commonality are equally real, then what you search out is only 50% truth. Because difference is also truth. But suppose difference is unreal, then you search out commonality and you see difference and know that it is unreal, then what? That is the truth. Therefore, between you and me, there are differences and there is something common. Differences are obvious. We are fighting also. Sometimes we fight with each other. We are jealous of each other. We dislike each other. Therefore, differences are obvious. Physical differences are there. Emotional differences are there. Tastes are different. And values are different. Everything is different. But then, there is something common between us. What is that common thing? Sentience. You are a sentient being. I am a sentient being. That is common. Okay. Let us, then there are common, there is a commonality and also there are differences. But the differences are unreal. They are appearance. Whereas commonality is the truth. The differences could be there. I raise above the differences at once. So, you see, once an immigration officer has held me back because of some suspicion. And I missed the flight. And then he released me. Now you are free to go. Then he looked at me and said, oh, you missed your flight? Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. You must be hating me. I told, no, I do not hate you. Why? You are doing your duty. Why should I hate you? Oh, you do not really hate me? I said, no, I do not hate you. We are brothers. I do not hate you. Oh, thank you very much. So I came out. So we may differ, but that is not reason to hate. So what I mean is, there are differences, but then they are unreal. There is commonality, and that is the only reality. The sentience is the only real thing. When I say I am a human being, it is false. It is superimposition. I am a scholar, superimposition. And when you say it is an animal, it is superimposition. When you say I am a sentient being, you are right. That is a sentient being, you are right. And that sentience is not many. You see, the sense of separate existence, I exist separate and that exists separate, the sense of separate existence is nothing but a reflection of the same reality, the same sentience in different bodies. So one has to carefully cross that last hurdle of the sense of separate existence, the sense of alienation. That is the last hurdle. That is the fundamental ignorance. And so one has to carefully cross it. And that's why vichitya. Bhuteshu bhuteshu vichitya dhiraha. So sakshatkritya. Atmatattvam brahma vichitya. So it is the atmatattvam is the sentience. Brahma is the being. Both are one and the same. And it is common to all life forms. And of course it is common to all beings ultimately. So, but here the discussion is restricted to life. So, because the teaching is to a human being, to a living person, so you understand this truth, sakshat kritya. You see, the ego-based life is a very corruptive life it is. It is a very destructive and corruptive life, as Shankara says, so vinashanam it is. So, ego must be there, ego will be there, you need not make any attempt to protect it or safeguard it, it will be there. So, but it should not snarl up the whole living style. So what we should do is, this ego, we live under the tyranny of this ego. My ego is my problem, not any other thing. God created all problems. How do you know God created all problems? The fact is, your ego has created all problems. Why God should create problems to me? So, my ego has created my problems. And my samsara is a creation of my ego. And the only way to overcome this samsara created by ego is to resolve the ego, the sense of alienation in the whole. So you get out of the tyranny of ego by resolving in the ego, in the whole. That means save yourself by losing yourself. That is how it is. Then how should I lose myself? Then what happens if I lose myself? I'm not sitting here to answer any more on that. So, the life, ego-centric life, is life full of sorrow and ignorance. And that egocentric life is a life of desires, never-ending desires. And if only you examine these desires and carefully grow to the level of desirelessness, then life becomes spontaneous and natural. Now it is unnatural and abnormalities. There is nothing normality in it. And because all our desires or fears are very artificial, meaningless, and utterly despicable. Therefore, you just raise to the level of desirelessness and you will know that you are the impersonal reality and you are not the person, the shadow person, you are not. So come out of it. The ego. You see, there was one biologist, Julian Huxley or somebody. Julian Huxley, not Aldous Huxley. Aldous Huxley is another, Julian Huxley is a biologist. He's in biology, they talk of this individual. Because individual is a product of a living being, you know. It is associated with life. You take a life form. The life form, whether it is an animal or a human being or any creature, it has a sense of individuality associated with it. The dog, it behaves like an individual. They try to find out what is individuality. This is biological philosophy. Philosophy coming out of biology. So what is this sense of individuality? The dog, it has a master. It serves a master. It is hostile to new people. It just behaves like an individual, like any other human individual. So, similarly, this ant is there. It belongs to a group and it has some territorial connection and it doesn't go into another group. One ant from one group, if it strays into another group, that group tells this ant, oh come on, you are from outside, move away. and it moves away and it comes out and joins its own group. So this individual there, the individual behavior is there. What is this individual? Is it life is real? For scientists, life is real. So the biology science philosopher, he says, the self, the individual, the small individual, is the small individual is a method, is not an end. That is what it says. Is a method, not an end. Means what? It is not the goal. It is not the truth. By the time you reach the truth, this small individual will not be there. Then what is this small individual? What is the purpose of this small individual? Why is he there in the first place? Only a method. Means it is a method to know the truth. The self is a stepping stone or a method to know the truth. And by the time the truth is reached, the self, the individual self, small self, will be resolved in it. There will be no jiva. The jiva means the individual will not be there. Most of the theologians of the world and the dualistic philosophers are caught in this individual thing. They are caught in it. It just doesn't occur to them that this small ego, this individual, may be unreal, may be a method to a higher reality, may be an intermediary step to a higher reality. This thinking, this idea doesn't cross their mind. They are stuck with this individuality thing. Even philosophers and scientists, normal, simple philosophers, Western philosophers and scientists can recognize that this individual is only a method, not the goal or not the end. Whereas these theologians, they are stuck, they cannot recognize because they are horribly conditioned. They cannot come out of this self-hypnosis. So they go on pursuing that individual. You are an individual. You were having a different kind of birth earlier. Next you will have another birth. So that individual has to do this. It has to acquire punyam. Otherwise it will go to hell. Otherwise you will go to heaven. So this way, for them, the individual is the method and the individual is the end. Whereas even scientists know better than that. So this way, one has to resolve the self in the whole to save oneself. And also in practical terms, there is a joy and freedom in losing yourself, not in preserving yourself. Just lose yourself in the whole. Sometimes the whole is family. You lose yourself in the family. There is only family. There is no individual. There is only family. Lose yourself in the family. Lose yourself in the community. Lose yourself in the nation. Lose yourself in the humanity. Lose yourself in the entire life. That is bhuteshu bhuteshu vichitya dhiraha. Then what happens? So, the ahankara life is a shadow life. The reality will step in once you rise above this shadow life of ahankara. So, that is what he is telling. Pretya vyavrutya mamaham bhavalakshanat avidyarupat asmallokat uparamya sarvātmaikatvam advaitamāpannāḥ santaha amrutā bhavanti. People think that Advaita is a school of thought. Advaita is not a school of thought. Advaitamāpannāḥ means they have joined this school of thought. That is not the meaning. Advaita, Shankara has not started a school of thought for others to join it. Advaitamāpannāḥ means they have lost themselves in, or they have become one with. So they have resolved in that one without the second reality. Advaitamapannaha. So how they will become this Advaita? Pretya vyavrutya. Unless the person is dead to the egoic life, he cannot step into the portals of truth. That is how it is. So, pretya vyavrutya mamaham bhava lakshanat avidyarupat asmal lokat uparamya. That దట్ ఈస్ వాట్ ఇట్ ఈస్. సో టీకాకార సేస్ ఇట్ ఈస్ సద్యో ముక్తి అట్ హీర్ అండ్ నౌ ముక్తి. సో ఓన్లీ థింగ్ ఈజ్ వన్ హ్యాస్ టు బికమ్ డెడ్ టు ఈగోయిక్ లైఫ్. యు సీ దేర్ ఆర్ టూ వృత్తిస్, వెరీ స్పెషల్ వృత్తిస్. పాట్ వృత్తి పుష్ప వృత్తి ఇస్ థాట్. సో పాట్ థాట్, ఫ్లవర్ థాట్, దిస్ థాట్, దట్ థాట్, దే ఆర్ ఇన్యూమరబుల్. ఎండ్లెస్ నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ థాట్స్, కౌంట్లెస్ నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ థాట్స్, దెర్ ఇస్ నో ఎండ్ ఫర్ ఆల్ దీస్ థాట్స్. లెట్ దమ్ బి దేర్, దే ఆర్ నాట్ ది ఇష్యూ. దే కమ్ అండ్ గో, దే ఆర్ అన్రియల్. బట్ అహం మమ ఆర్ ది టూ థాట్స్. యు సీ ఐ ఆస్క్డ్ వన్ ద్వైతాచార్య. ద్వైతాచార్య మీన్స్ ఈజ్ ఏ వండర్ఫుల్ పర్సన్, ఏ వైదిక అండ్ డివోటెడ్, వెరీ వండర్ఫుల్ లైఫ్ స్టైల్. సో వన్స్ ఐ డిడ్ నమస్కార్ టు హిమ్. హీ సెడ్, వాట్ ఈజ్ ఇట్, యూ ఆర్ అన్ అద్వైత స్కాలర్ అండ్ మహాత్మా, వై యూ డూ నమస్కార్ టు యూ, యూ ఆర్ ఎ గ్రేట్ పర్సన్ అండ్ ఐ కెన్ సీ సమ్ గ్లోరీ ఇన్ యూ. వాట్ ఈజ్ ద గ్లోరీ యూ సీ ఇన్ మీ? యువర్ లైఫ్ స్టైల్ ఈజ్ వండర్ఫుల్. యూ లివ్ ఏ వెరీ సింపుల్ లైఫ్ అండ్ యూ డోంట్ బాదర్ టు ఫేస్ డిఫికల్టీ. You don't, some of the methods you follow, a very simple lifestyle, I can learn a lot from it. So like this, a discussion went on. So, you see, when I see a Vaidika, a very devoted person, a bhakta, I need not know from Atma Brahma from him. From everybody I need not know Atma Brahma. He is a devotee. And he has that tapas in him, penance in him, and I can see that point in him and forget about the rest. Anyway, I was okay with him. I don't have any problem. So, then the discussion went on. Then he told me, how do you say the world is unreal? That is his problem. I told him, leave alone, sir. Why you worry? Our bhiksha time is approaching. Let us take care of that. Why you worry about the world is real and unreal? Bhiksha is real, I tell you. So, other things real or unreal, bhiksha is real. No, no, not like that. I know what you mean. But I want to know, you tell me. How do you say the world is real or unreal? Then I told him, you see, you think about it. When you say the world is real, it is not the world as such that you are trying to validate. You are not trying to validate the wall is real, the roof is real, the bulb is real, the trees are real, the grass is real. That is not what you are trying to validate. When you say the world is real, you are trying to validate aham mama, me, mine, through the world. Suppose something is there which has no connection with me, mine, then you are not interested in establishing its reality or its falsehood or whatever. Some blessed thing is there somewhere, and now in which way I am connected, whether it is real or unreal, what I get if I establish that it is unreal or real, why, in which way I am connected? No, the problem is, you while saying that the world is real, you are saying that your ego is real, aham is real, me, mine are real. That is your problem. Therefore, so while saying the world is real, the world is beautiful, one gentleman told me the world is celebratorial. That is what he told me. He says he is a professor of religion. It's a celebratorial. Lord Shri Krishna celebrated the world. Why you come and talk that world is unreal? I told, don't tell me about Lord Shri Krishna celebrating the world and all that. So don't tell me stories. You try to read what Sri Krishna said in Gita, if you understand anything. Never try to connect a person's stories about a person and his philosophy. Those are two different things. Don't connect the two, because the connection may not be there. And so, because there are so many stories around Sri Krishna, and you want to judge Sri Krishna on the basis of stories? No, you should not do that mistake, especially when these people, historic people, they are so far separated in time from us, and the people start worshipping them as gods, and there is so much mythology develops around them. Every poet comes and shows his poetic skills about that person, and now you talk about that person and his philosophy and try to connect all these stories. It is not fair. We should not do that. So Sri Krishna celebratorial this and that, you keep it aside. What he taught, you see, it is there as a clear record. Therefore, what we are doing, what these Dvaitins are doing, without understanding this fact, this is the weakness. While saying the world is real, through the world, you are validating me, mine. That is what it is. Otherwise, if me, mine is not connected, then I care two hoots whether the world is real or unreal. Me, mine is connected. World is real because me, mine is real. Knowingly or unknowingly, the human endeavor in validating the world is, he is validating himself. So this is the truth. And therefore, as long as you validate me, mine, you may use the worldly life to do that, or you may use the scriptures to do that, you may use systems to do that. In whichever way you do it, you validate me, mine, you are bound to remain in the darkness of ignorance, nowhere. One is to die for me, mine, pretya. Aham, pretya means not physical death we are talking about. The life continues, the spontaneous life becomes natural for a change, because this me, mine life, it is abnormal. There is nothing normal about it. All its desires and fears are abnormal, unnatural, and unreal, and unworthy. So, once the person comes out of this me, mine, mama aham bhava lakshanat, avidya, Shankara's glory comes out in the Bhashya. Shankara Bhashyam is not easy. Very simple words you can translate, therefore it is easy. If anybody thinks like that, he has missed the whole point. Somebody told me, Shankara's Gita Bhashyam is very simple. Yeah, it is very simple. That is the problem. If it is not that simple, probably we would have shown more interest in it and more correctly we have understood. Gita Bhashyam is the toughest Bhashyam. Because Shankara is like a tiger. We never know when he pounces upon you. He drops in a word which you will altogether miss, and you have missed everything by missing that word. So, he is very powerful Bhashyakara, and you need any number of Mahatmas, Tikas help to appreciate his heart. So you see, Pretya, Vyavrutya, so having died, what is that that I have to die for? So Mamaham Bhava Rakshanat, Avidya Rupat, Asmal Lokat, that is the Loka. The world that you are talking about, the Loka that you are talking about, is nothing independent of mama and aham, the world of names and forms. That's why I say every world description is a subjective world description. People say, my world and his world is same. How can you say waking state is unreal? You are mistaken, sir. They are not same. The day your me, mine and his me, mine become one by merging in the truth, that day they will be same. Till then, your world is your world and his world is his world. No two worlds are ever same. Because your world is, it is centered around me, mine. And his world is not centered around your me, mine. His world is centered around another me, mine. Which is supposed to be different from your me, mine. How your two worlds are the same? There may be some overlaps here and there. That doesn't mean that they are same. So, anyway, mama aham bhava lakshanat. So these are the two vrittis, two thoughts. Everything is a thought. Ego is a thought. Ego is not some separate entity or any such thing. It's a thought. And mind is another thought. And both thoughts are in place only because of ignorance. Avidya rupat. Avyakta, vyakta. Up to that it is God's creation. Avyakta is God. Vyakta is God's creation, because God himself manifests. Up to that, God. Beyond that, there is no God. Vyakti is ignorance. So, aham. So, seeing is God. Hearing is God. I see, where I is the individual, or ego, is the jiva, ignorance. Avidya, rupat, mama, these two vrittis. So, You see, me, mine, as they apply to the intellect, my scholarship, you know, the mind, means my feelings, my emotions, and then the sense organs, I see, my sight, then the actions, I do, I act, then the world, my world. So as long as the vrittis, me, mine, are connected to intellect, mind, sense organs, vital force, the physical body, and the world, as long as me, mine are connected to these six, it is samsara. When me, mine are connected to Ishvara, I belong to Ishvara, all mine means what? My intellect, my thinking faculty, my body, my sense organs, and my house, my this, my that, it all belongs to Ishvara. I belong to Ishvara, mine belongs to Ishvara. This is true bhakti. This is bhakti. You keep me, mine intact, and I ask, expect Ishvara to do a few things for you. While you are nicely sleeping, Ishvara should come and clean the front of a porch and put some this thing and that thing and go away so that you can get up to a nice thing. This is what people want Ishvara to do. And if he doesn't do that, the mess which I create, he should clear it. By night time I create a mess, by the time I wake up, he should clear all that mess. So with a broomstick every night. Early morning he should clear, so that by the time I wake up, the mess will not be there. This is what people want Ishvara to do. So, I tell you, that is not bhakti. Bhakti, it is not bhakti means it is called gauna bhakti. Everything is validated. Why to drop anything? Everything is taken into account. Veda, you know, Veda is like a supermarket. Everything is there in it. So, gauna bhakti is also validated, but not real bhakti. In Vedanta, we do not connect me, mine to the world, and we do not connect it to Ishvara. We just sublate it into Atmajnanam. Negate it. Nishedha. If it is real, then you have to connect it either to samsara, either to the world, then it becomes samsara, or you connect it to Ishvara when it becomes bhakti. That is two ways. One is bandha, that is bhakti will give moksha. But finally you will know that you sublate, that is how moksha. Yes, it is my habit to present everything in bhakti jnana, jnana bhakti like that. That is how I do it. That is my style. I am not saying anything other than that. Bhakti and jnana. I am not talking of any paths or any such thing. Just the same concept, I put it in the language of bhakti. And whatever is in the language of bhakti, I put in the language of jnana. Because, as I can see, there is no difference between the two. So, this is the me, mine are Ishvara's bhakti. Me, mine are unreal. And the awareness, the being alone is real. Jnana. I see no difference between the two. I see only the verbal difference, not the difference in vastu. So, that is how uparamya, one who raises from this me mind. So here Tikakara says, pretya means not dying away, not physical death that is being talked. In Vedanta we don't talk of physical death and all that. When on one side we say there is no death for you and then again talk of physical death. Pretya is not physical death. Pretya is dying to me mind, dying to ignorance, dying to samsara. So uparamya, that's why uparamya, withdrawn. Then what happens once me, mine are sublated, what remains is sarvatmaikatvam. That is the sarvatma bhava. So, the same is it that makes the hair grow, that makes the blood flow in the veins. There is a life here. makes the hair grow, makes the blood flow in the veins. It is the same that gives the power to see and the power to speak. It is the same that makes the trees grow, makes the birds fly. Same it is, same sentience. It is the same power that makes the earth go round the sun, that burns in the wombs of these stars as nuclear fusion and all that. So, that is the divinity, that is the God. And every human, not only every human being, every life form is full of that divinity. Even mosquito is full of divinity, a bacterium is full of divinity, and a human being is full of divinity. And the same divinity appears in all animals, in all living beings, in all trees. The same divinity appears in friends and in foes and relations and enemies. The same divinity appears. So when you shut eyes to the divisions and see, open the eyes, awaken to that divinity in all life, then the divinity will be established in your own heart. Advaitamapannasantaha. That is the Sarvatma Bhava. A lot can be said about Sarvatma Bhava. So yastu sarvani bhutani atmanyevanu pasyate, etc. A lot can be said about Sarvatma Bhava. So entire Upanishads are there on Sarvatma Bhava. Atma is all. So that state of Sarvatma Bhava means oneness with the whole, oneness with the all. That is the Sarvatma Bhava. That is a spontaneous state, a natural state. Separation is artificial. There is no reality to that. Even I say, I am this body. This body is an integral part of this Panchabhuta, the elemental world. It is like a bubble in a body of water. The bubble, it has originated from the body of water. It exists in the existence of that body of water, and it finally merges in the body of water. It just can't stand apart from the body of water. It is unthinkable. So similarly, this body as it is existing, it is unthinkable that it is separate from the whole. Thank God it is not separate from the whole. I take it to be separate from the whole. Suppose my wish, my thinking becomes right, then I will fall dead in half second. Thank God my thinking is not right. It continues to be in the whole. Suppose it is, I think I am separate from the whole, then really my thinking becomes right, then I will fall dead. I will not be there to make one more thinking. Because you are separated means you fall dead, that's all. The body, you see, to put it scientifically, the body is nothing but positive entropy. Whereas in the universe, it is all negative entropy. Life is positive entropy. It is all an ocean of negative entropy. Heat, you know, a disorder. It's an ocean of negative entropy. And in that ocean of negative entropy, you have a bubble of positive entropy. Yes, you don't worry about it. Having started it, I am saying it and I will finish it now. So, under this positive entropy is given a name called individual. There is no individual. There is only positive entropy. So, when the carbon dioxide and oxygen, they are in the outside, they are dispersed. That is disorder. Dispersion is disorder. That is the entropy. And when the same carbon dioxide and water are absorbed by a plant, they are put together into a glucose molecule. So dispersion is negative entropy, put together is positive entropy. And that is what life is. What is continuously dispersed in the universe is put together and brought together and made into a structure, order, by the life. All life form is like that. Therefore, even while I stand here, there is no difference with the surroundings except that the organization of the elements. In the surroundings, the five elements are there, organized in a different entropy way. The same five elements are organized here in a different entropy way. but for that organization there is no individual involved, and this organization of elements is the handiwork of that higher power called Ishvara or divinity, and that is the Atma, that is the Brahman, and that one has to know that advaitam apanna santaha amruta bhavanti. For a person who knows this truth, there is no death, because what is going to die? What is it that will die? Will the body die? It never lived. Where is the question of body dying? It never lived. And will the life die? Come on, life is not going to die. Will the matter die? No. Will the consciousness die? No. Will the Atma, the awareness, die? No. Will the being die? No. There is nothing which is going to die. Next. Brahmaiva bhavanti. Ityattha. Amruta bhavanti means immortal they become, means they become the Brahman. They become the supreme reality. That is the meaning of it. It's not that some extra quality called immortality is acquired by them. It's not like that. So now I am immortal. You are all mortals, I am immortal. So now I have a qualification which none of you have. It's not like that. Amruta bhavanti means Brahma bhavanti. You become the whole. Sayohavai. Tat paramam brahma veda. Brahmaiva bhavati. Iti shrutehe. Yeah. So, yaha tat paramam brahma veda. One who knows the supreme reality called the Brahman. There is only one way of knowing it. That is the all. Including the me mine, that is the all. Once who knows the truth, why indeed saha, that person, brahmaiva bhavati, he becomes one with the Brahman. It is shrute. Bhavati means becomes. Now, he becomes means what? How can you say he becomes? He is Brahman. How can you say he becomes Brahman? I do not say anything. It is shrute. Shruti says so. How Shruti says? Yeah, that is a point. You can ask that and I can answer. How Shruti says becomes Brahman? Yeah, Shruti says becomes Brahman because as of now you are not Brahman. Are you Brahman now? Yes, I am Brahman. Okay. Then Shruti doesn't apply to you. No, I have not yet realized my truth. Yeah, then it applies to that person who did not know, and then he knew. When he did not know, he is Brahman. But then he is an individual also, a limited person. When he knew it, he is not a limited individual anymore. He is Brahman. Yeah, this change, apparent change brought about by knowledge, is the becoming. What is the creation? The creation is not a thing. Creation is an eternal becoming in the timeless being. That is what creation is. So becoming is it resolves in the being, and being blossoms as the becoming. Sayohavai tat paramam brahma veda brahmaiva bhavati. I have come out of that Brahman as a bubble out of ocean, and I go back into that Brahman. There is no coming out, there is no going back. It's a standpoint. It is shrute. Om purnamada purnamidam purnat purnamudachyate purnasya purnamadaya purnamevavashishyate. Om shanti shanti shantihi. हरिः ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः. हरिः ओम तत्सत् श्री कृष्णार्पणमस्तु.